cosmic law that Nanak calls it as Hukum. There is a particular question that I will also take during this session. The question is, the person asks, Jesus is considered as Son of God. Now, I will begin this with a story I have heard. A woman lived in a village. It was a small village. That village did not have any clock. So they did not know how to find the time. This woman had a cock. So every morning the cock will crow and then sun will rise. And it always happened that sun will rise only after the cock crow. This gave the old woman the impression that crowing of the cock and rising of the sun are interrelated. Every morning when the cock crows, the sun rises. The woman got arrogant. She convened the entire village and told everyone to respect her. She said, "If you are not paying respect or taking care of me, I will leave this village and migrate to the neighboring village. And once I move out of this place, sun will not shine in your village." And then it happened. The villagers got angry and they did not support the old woman. One day the woman migrated to the neighboring village. She had a doubt whether the sun will rise here or not. But to her surprise, in the morning cock crew, the sun rose, and this confirmed her belief that sun rises only because of her cock. She was convinced now sun will not rise in the other village. The logic of the woman is straightforward and crystal clear as well. It never happened that sun would rise and cock did not crow. Now that woman had moved to the neighboring village and the sun rose when the cock crew, then how can sun rise in the other village? This is the kind of intelligence we all have. With your intelligence, you think within the narrow boundaries of limited intelligence. God does not exist because of you. Instead, you exist because of God. And God is not a person sitting somewhere. It is the totality. Some total of all that exists is God. You exist and float within the divine placenta. I love a Sufi story very much. A master had few disciples. They were simple, very loving, but the level of intelligence was like you and I. The master wanted the disciples to seek the correct master, so he gave them a riddle, so that after him, they will be able to discover the master. He said, "When I leave, I have 17 camels. I want you all to have these camels as my gift to you. The first one will get half of the camel, 9. The second one will get 1/3 of the camel, which is 6. And the remainder of the 2 camels will go to the third person." The 3 disciples moved from place to place with 17 camels, to the priest, to logician, to philosophers, to thinkers, to all of them, to ask them to divide these 17 camels among us in this particular proportion. The first one gets half of the camels, 9. The second one gets 1/3, that is 6. and the remainder person gets the two. No one could find the answer. Then one day they met a Sufi master. He said, they presented the parable, the riddle to the Sheikh. He said, that is not a problem. I will divide this as your master wished. But 17 camels cannot be divided. Camel is a living thing, is not like a portion of any almonds or cashew nuts or things like these. So what he said, I have one of my camel. I will add my camel to yours. So 17 will become 18, and 18 is a divisible number. Now the first one has to get half of the camel, 9. So half of 18 is 9. First one gets 9 camels. The second one is supposed to get 1/3 of the camels, that is 6. So 1/3 of 18 is 6, he gets 6 camels. First one got 9, second one got 6. Now one person remained, and there are 2-3 camels. One belonged to the Sheikh, and the other two, that was the part of the inheritance. The Sheikh said, I take back my camel that I used only to solve this riddle. The remainder gets 2 according to your condition. The 17 camels were divided. This story is full of insights. As an individual, you cannot solve the problems that you confront. You are trying to understand the words of masters with your intelligence, with your understanding. You think that you understand English. Jesus spoke Aramaic, not even Hebrews. And you don't understand that language. It has to be translated into English. But a master does not understand the language. He do not need to. He only connects, reaches to the same spot, same level of consciousness that Jesus has, or Nanak has, or Kabir has, or for that matter, any Sheikh or master has. When you reach to that level of consciousness, the words become meaningless and you understand the message. When someone asks, well, is Jesus the Son of God? You have heard this from priests many times. Belief system never works. Any little doubt, beliefs shatters. How does What is the process for a child to be born? For a child to be born, there has to be interaction at the physical level where ovum and sperm will interact with one another. This is in common language known as act of sex. But before you go into act of sex, there is a thought. You are thinking of the physical act, and when there is a mutual consent, the act is given a particular name. And when there is not a consent from either of the two, that particular act is termed by a different name. So where does the thought come from? The thought is one thing. Thought is, behind the thought, there is light, there is awareness. And this thought comes from an unknown source. Remember, Mirza Ghalib says, Aate hain ye mazami khayal mein ghaib se. All the thoughts comes from an unknown source. And I am like the when you put the pen on to the paper, there is a sound. And the sound that is there is that of an angel. So first comes the consciousness, and then guided by that you enter into the physical act. Your consciousness may be subdivided, may be at the level of lust, may be at different levels. And it is said Jesus is born out of Virgin Mary. You try to understand this word Virgin Mary in your own understanding, which I call as asinine intelligence. It's a harsh word, but there cannot be any better word to understand this. You think Virgin means this? No. When you are entering into the physical act, what is at what level of consciousness you are? Are you in a total consciousness, that of wholeness, that of divinity, that we are all one? And if the consciousness is at that level, then the physical act will happen at the physical plane. This is also known as the state of meditation. So intense that the act is taking place at the physical plane and your consciousness or thought is not involved into that. It is something like this. Sometimes you are concentrated in your work. So much in your work, but you are still hungry, you drink tea, you eat this, you eat that. You are oblivious of what you are eating, because even while you are eating, you are thinking of that particular problem or particular thought that is in your mind. The act is taking place at the physical plane of eating, but at the level of consciousness, you are somewhere else. Sometimes people are talking, they are at a different level. That is consciousness. If your consciousness is total, that I am part of this cosmic existence, cosmic harmony, oneness, and that sum total of that cosmic oneness is God. So when it is said Jesus is born, is Son of God, yes, indeed He is Son of God. Jesus is Son of God, but not in that case. I would like to add one thing more. God is not a person sitting somewhere, and if that be, according to Christian, the world was created nearly 6,000 years before, so God would be a 6,000 year old person. No, God is consciousness. As Nanak calls it as the Hukum, there is an existential sound nobody has created. Ek Omkar Satnam, that is one. The nature of that is uncreated sound, no one has created it, it exists. That is truth. And that is the only name. When Moses asked, how would I call you? He said, I am that I am. And this is the name that I will be known as. Yes, if you tell somebody, what is your name? I am that I am. He said, are you crazy or what? You must have a name. But this is how God told Moses, and it is known as Moses' code. I am that I am. Hindu scripture says, Tattvamasi, I am that you are that you are. Aham Brahmasmi, I am ever expanding consciousness. So, and then he explains the qualities, the only doer, fearless, without any prejudice, beyond time and space, born out of his own free will. When a person dies full of awareness, he has a choice to choose his parents, the time of birth, place of birth. He can choose that. So Jesus has chosen that because of his past birth. And that is why we call Jesus as Son of God. And then continuing that, Nanak says, that which is true in the beginning, true now, and true under all circumstances and situations. The definition of truth, that which never changes, remains ever fixed. It was, it will always be so. And by thinking you cannot understand this, by remaining silent, forcing a silent, you cannot understand this, then he wants to know when there will be a dawn of truth. When truth will dawn, when the veil of ignorance vanish, Nanak says, flow with the cosmic law. Hukum rajai charana Nanak likhiya naal. Everything moves according to that law, that you can call commandment. Everything moves according to that. There is a precise law. How do the trees know that spring is coming? You have to look into the calendar and the dates and everything. The tree is in total harmony with existence because there is no name. It is said, the birds that are living in the coastal towns, whenever there is a storm or hurricane or anything is supposed to come, they get the intentions and they get the feeling, and the birds and the animal move away from there to the safe side. But man has evolved, but his mind is evolved, but not consciousness. So he don't understand this. There is a cosmic law. Everything moves according to that. Aurobindo calls it, there is a power within that knows beyond our knowings. We are not aliens, nor as a strangers join. We are bound to each other by a causeless force. But we live into divided state. This is mine, that is yours. And then how can you attain to totality? Nanak says that this hukum is a divine pleasant time which we all move. There is seasons, the autumn, the winter, the spring, everything moves according to that. If you really understand this, only then you can understand the message contained in the words of the masters, whether it is Jesus, whether it is Muhammad, whether it is Kabir, whether it is Nanak or anyone else. Every syllable that Nanak spoke is filled with tremendous insight. So do not try to understand the words of Jesus in your own understanding. Let there be a light. And when I gave you the story of 17 camels, the 18th camel is the light, represents the light, the understanding, the awareness that master is. He puts his energy field into you, lends it until everything settles in you and you transcend. The moment that becomes part of your own understanding, he withdraws himself and leaves you totally independent. The purpose of a shape, the purpose of a master, the enlightened one, is to lend you his awareness so that you too can attain to the same flowering that once happened to me. One day I was also groping in darkness like you all, stumbling here and there, getting hurt, Then light shone. Someone lent his light, and with that, awakening happened. That is the work of the masters. Now let us go into sutra, that is according to Nanak. It is Hukum, or the cosmic law, that creates all forms and names. Whether it is Jesus, whether it is Buddha, it is that cosmic law, out of that comes into existence all forms and names. Hukum cannot be put into the words. Try to understand the word Hukum. It is cosmic law. The principle that guides everything. The principle that creates synergistic harmony. The principle that moves from chaos to cosmos. That principle, Nanak calls it as Hukum, the cosmic law. It is because of this Hukum that the entire creation came into existence. All fame, name happens because of this. When you attain to something or achieve success or gain or lose something, it is all happening because of this cosmic law. When people ask me to bless someone, it becomes difficult for me because I know my blessings or curse cannot help you or anyone. But yet still we go on blessing and using the curse onto the other. It never works. It is your understanding. It is your flowing with the cosmic law that works. If you have that, if you have experienced that within, you will not seek blessings from anyone. Because your own existence, your own understanding is blessing. I don't seek blessings from anyone because my understanding, my awareness, my flowing with that harmony is blessing. When you attain to something, be thankful. When you lose, let thy will prevail. This is why Hindus call that this world is a play or leela of God. It means all changes happen on the axle, and that axle is God. You are simply the instrument. The problem comes when the instrument or the equipment considers itself the doer. It is something like the electrical appliance considering itself the doer. Apparently, it appears that it is the electrical appliance that is functioning. It is the electric current that cooks your food via the medium of a stove. Your stove is the equipment that has the capability to manifest one of the qualities of the electrical energy. It is the electrical energy or current that cooks the food on the stove. It cannot happen otherwise. As an aspirant, you need to understand this. This is why in Bhagavad Gita, Krishna tells Arjuna to understand it. It is he, Krishna, is the only doer. But we consider ourselves to be the doer. If someone does not do things according to your liking, you become antagonistic to that person. Sometimes we do not talk to the person. It is he who is creating everything, big or small. And when he is the creator, then why there is duality? When a sculpturist makes a big or small statue, there can be no difference between the two. Two statues are made by the same person, for different purposes. When you go to the market and you look at the statues of laughing Buddha in different colors, different sizes, different postures, because people have different likings of the color, the size, if you have to put an image of laughing Buddha on the dashboard of your car, you cannot have a 12-inch. And when you want to put a laughing Buddha in your living room, you cannot have a 2-inch laughing Buddha there. There you need a 12-inch, 18-inch or whatever size you can afford. So a sculpturist has to make these statues of different sizes for different purposes. There is no difference whether it is big or small. The statue of laughing Buddha or Buddha, big or small, serve the same purpose. The purpose of two statues may differ. The entire creation is permeated by one doer. However, man creates the duality. And this duality is cause of your pain, misery and despondency. This way you will never attain to bliss because you are divided. You are against this one or that one. You nourish this acrimony throughout the life. Sometimes it happens we nourish this acrimony between the husbands and wives, between friends for life long. When your vision is of the outer, when you can only see the name and form, you will never attain to fruition. Misery will be your way. On the contrary, if you are able to envision the invisible hands of the Creator behind the creation, you attain to the magnanimity the very moment. It is these invisible hands that create the insignificant blade of grass and also tall pine trees. Nanak says when he creates the two significant and insignificant things, then how can there be duality? We are all like pawns. All victory and failure is his. Such is the way of your religious ones. More than often religious claim all success and fame belonging to him and all failures belonging to me. This is also, this we consider as a humility, that all success goes to God and all failure is because of me. In reality, this is false. This is the subtle way of ego. How can failure belong to me and success belong to him? The two belong to the same. Observe when someone claims that he is the speck of dust at your feet. There is a desire to be something reflecting through his eyes. Nanak says entire creation comes into existence because of this cosmic law. Christians say that God willed and the world came into existence. According to Hindus, it is Brahma who created the world. There is a group, a function taking place. Group of people, various arrangements have to be made. Someone has to take care of the security, someone has to take care of the other aspects, someone has to take care of the cooking. So the one who is taking care of the cooking is known as cook. The one who is taking care of the other management is known by different name. People have to be transported, they are known as transporters. So Hindus have a very wide system. Brahma is the creator. When something has been created, the guests have come. The driver's responsibility is to transport you from airport to the place of your stay. Then after dropping you at the place, he goes to pick up the next set of people. you are placed in the hands of the other caretakers. Then when they settle you, show you your room and provide all the amenities, they give you a ticket that this is your the lunch and dinner coupon. With that, you go to the respective area. You are being attended by different people. The three aspects of creation: the creation, the preservation, and the destruction. Hindus call this by these responsibilities are given to three different entities. They are known as the Trinity: Brahma, the creator, Vishnu, the preserver, and Shiva, the destroyer. Nothing, Nanak says, the entire, and then the sum total of this, it is the same energy that works. One who conceived this conference, this particular retreat, he is one energy. He delegates the responsibility to different people to make it happen. Hukum is that solitary law that gets divided, just as there is one composite atom. And where does this world come from? It comes from the Sanskrit root Atman, atom. God divided into three: neutron, proton, and electron. Different configurations of this create different metals and so on. If we can understand the scientific analogy, we can understand the religious aspects. Nanak says entire creation comes into existence because of this cosmic law, the consciousness. Hukum cannot be put into the words. Consciousness or God or whatever it is cannot be put into the words, name or form. So when Jesus says, I am Son of God, yes indeed he is Son of God. Yes indeed he was born out of Virgin Mary. I can speak to you out of my own experience. Yes, Jesus is born out of Virgin Mary. When Mary and Joseph was in the physical act through which Jesus' body was formed, their consciousness was not at the level of lovemaking or sex. It is total. It was a state of meditation, total absorption in that existential law. Then this act is not considered as a physical act. It becomes, instead its qualities change, and it becomes an act of meditation. Jesus is born out of this state of meditation, yet still the act has to take place at the physical plane. It is the energy at which Joseph was completely under that influence that we call in Christianity as Holy Spirit. It was under that influence. Joseph's body was there, but consciousness was not that of Joseph. When that state comes in, when your body is involved in the physical act, but your consciousness is not into that, that state of meditativeness, in Christianity we call Jesus is born out of Virgin Mary. And that person, his body is of Mary and Joseph, but consciousness is of that God, that oneness. Jesus indeed is Son of God. You too are Son of God, but you knew it not. You have not experienced that which is unborn. One day someone asked me, do you think Sai Baba is an incarnation? Now the person is expecting me to say yes. He would have heard many times from the people, but did he believe? Because it is not his experience. So he goes on asking this one and that one and everyone that he meets, and he thinks that this person is religious somewhat, We ask him the question, is Sai Baba an incarnation? So I said, answer me one question. If Sai Baba is incarnation, then are you a cockroach? He said, what do you mean? I said, exactly the same what I said. You said Sai Baba is an incarnation. He said, I asked you a question. I said, your question cannot be answered directly. If you think Sai Baba is an incarnation, then who are you? A cockroach? A cockroach is trying to understand that, is Sai Baba an incarnation? No, you cannot understand this. Yes, indeed, everything comes out of that consciousness, that hukum, that cosmic law. Sai Baba was a seed, was a potentiality that got the opportunity, blossomed into a flower, but you still remain a seed, and that seed may with the passage of time rot and it did not attain to its fruition. That's the only difference between you and me. A seed that has blossomed and gave birth to many flowers, and then even in the process of withering this, when the flower withers away, it gives way to many seeds. Out of one seed, millions of flowers blossom, and out of one flower, millions of seeds are born. It is a reversible process, reversible equation. It's not that from one seed one flower will come and one flower one seed comes. No. Many flowers are blossomed from one seed and many seeds come out of one flower. The words are incapable to express that which is magnanimous. And that which is magnanimous cannot be expressed in that. In any way, try to understand this. First, all that is magnanimous can only be felt in deep meditation, deep silence. And that which evolves out of your inner silence then cannot be put into the words. When an aspirant experiences this deep within, there is no words, only silence is there. There is no way to express this into words. I have heard a Sufi story which is beautiful. Once a shopkeeper was taking care of his... There was a sheep keeper. He was taking care of his sheep on a hilltop. Every day his wife will bring food for him at lunchtime. It happened that this day his wife did not bring the food. He felt hungry, very hungry. Many thoughts began to creep in his mind. Maybe she is sick. Maybe she met another incident. And thoughts like these began to plague his mind. He looked around if he could find someone nearby who could take care of the sheep and he could reach home to bring the food. Suddenly he spotted a woodcutter on the branch of a nearby tree cutting wood. He went to the woodcutter to ask him to take care of his sheep until he could reach home and bring the food. But the woodcutter was busy in his work, so he found this quite disturbing. The sheep keeper asked the woodcutter to take care of his sheep until he comes back from home. The woodcutter and luckily the woodcutter was deaf. He did not listen anything. Just to avoid the man, he signaled him to go, meaning not to disturb him. Sheepkeeper thought this to be the tacit consent for his request. So he ran home to pick up the food On returning, he counted the sheep and found them correct. He was filled with gratitude. Amidst his flock, he had a lame sheep. This he decided to present to the woodcutter as his gratitude. So the sheepkeeper picked up the lame sheep and carried it to the woodcutter. The deaf woodcutter thought that the sheepkeeper is blaming him for making his sheep lame. None could understand the other. So both of them went on blaming each other and kept on putting their point, but all in vain. Just in retrospect, does it not happen in our lives on a day-to-day basis? We keep on blaming the other for all failures and shortcomings and never arrive at any judgment or decision. They were arguing. The sheepkeeper said, "I am thankful to you that you have taken care of my sheep while I was away. So I want to give you this as my gift to you." The deaf woodcutter said, "I have nothing to do with your sheep. I was busy with that. I did not do anything for your sheep to get lame. Both are playing their own trumpet and there is no harmony. It's like an orchestra. Every instrument playing its own tune and there is chaos. This is how our lives is." Suddenly a horse rider came who has lost his way nearby, and he came to inquire the way. Now seeing the rider, the sheepkeeper and the woodcutter tried to explain their points. The woodcutter tried to explain his point and he tried to prove his innocence, that he is not responsible for lameness of the sheep. The traveler has stolen a horse and he thought these to be the owner of the horse. He was also deaf, so he pleaded his case without understanding the other. He was pleading his case that whosoever this horse belonged to, take that. Without understanding each other, they were pleading their case. Look at this simple parable. How does it relate to each one of our lives? We keep on blaming the other without understanding the other's point. You did so. This complicated the situation. The two deaf and one argued their point without understanding anyone. As they were arguing, a Sufi passed by. The three got hold of the Sufi, who had taken a vow to remain silent. He listened to the three. Now how can this matter be resolved? The Sufi used a methodology. First, he looked deeply into the eyes of the horse rider. The horse rider began to feel restless and hypnotized. He rode the horse and disappeared into the woods. Now the Sufi looked into the eyes of the sheepkeeper, who also almost felt intoxicated. He too vowed to the Sufi and chased the sheep homewards. Now the turn of the woodcutter. Woodcutter could not understand what was happening. However, the unknown happens. Whenever unknown happens, or something unknown and unknowable try to filter into your life, you are frightened. There were tremendous force in the eyes of the Sufi. So when he looked into the eyes of the woodcutter, he forgot everything and started getting busy in his work. Whenever an individual attains to inwardness, or the fruition happens, a different glow comes into the eyes. The entire life energy gets centered into the eyes, and eyes are the only medium of expression. The woodcutter also got frightened and left for home. The master resolved the matter without uttering a single word. Such is the problem with the masters. Masters have to deal with death. This deafness arises because of inner dialogue. Everyone goes on speaking, and no two persons understand one another. Master communicates through eyes. This is the reason the commune or the association of the master is considered essential. Nothing can be said. That which is can only be indicated. Whatever the masters say are like the milestones. These indicate that you are in the right direction. Nanak says, never hold on to any milestone. I have heard another story. There was a Muslim king. He had a slave. I have explained this many times, but again and again, remembrance is important. The slave was very loving. King loved him dearly. The slave was very devoted. One day the two were passing through the forest. On the way, king picked up a fruit and gave a peck to the slave. The slave went on asking for more and more, and the king went on giving until he reached the last peck. This too the slave wanted, but the king wanted to taste at least the last peck, as there was no other fruit on the tree. So instead of giving the last peck to the slave, king tasted himself. And as the king put the peg into his mouth, he could not eat. The fruit was bitter. This surprised the king, because slave did not complain of the taste of the fruit. And each time the slave ate the fruit, he relished. The fruit was bitter like poison. It was difficult even to taste the fruit, what to talk of eating. Surprisingly, the king inquired from the slave, how could you eat the entire fruit joyfully? Why did you not complain? And the reply of the slave is very beautiful. This is the reply of an awakened one. The slave responded, these hands have given so many joyous moments. Then how can I complain for one bitter fruit? And what is your position? Every moment you are getting increments, increases, this thing and that thing, but the but remains always but that always remains. He says, how can I complain for one bitter fruit? This is the response of the one who knows. This is the response of a religious one. The day you understand that all that happens in life is because of this cosmic law, Hukum, how can you reject sorrows and afflictions? You are not able to see the truth. When the leaves fall from the tree during autumn, the tree becomes bare. This is not the end. This is the way the tree protects itself. Each time autumn comes, old leaves fall. And during the spring, each time when autumn comes, and after that spring comes, it gives a new shape and form to the tree. This is the way of the growth of the tree. Both sorrow and happiness are two shores of the river of life. The river of life cannot flow without these two shores. The day you are beyond the duality, if you are concerned with this shore and that shore, you cannot leave the shore, and by standing on the shore, you cannot enter the depth of the ocean or depth of the river. For that, you have to forget the shore and enter the river, the flow of the river. Both sorrow and happiness are two shores of the river of life. The river of life cannot flow without these two shores. The day you are beyond the duality of happiness and sorrow, bliss or anand happens. When duality is no more, oneness comes. Nanak says, everyone is under, nothing is beyond the cosmic law Hukum. Both happiness and sorrow are the outcome of this cosmic law. It is the cosmic law Hukum that brings blessings for someone. It is because of the Hukum someone remains within the cycle of birth and death, and one who really understands this cosmic law Hukum is free from ego and attains to oneness. This is the essence of all religions and the understanding of Buddhas. This is religiousness. Religious does not come by going to the temples, churches, mosques or gurdwaras, or holding your scriptures, or holding your scriptural injunctions. You can put on the garb of a religious one, but this cannot make you a religious really. It happens many a time, realizing the futility of ego, you want to drop it, yet still you cannot drop. What can really be the cause of this? Ego gives you happiness. This alone is the problem. This is true as well. All suffering, misery and pain are the outcome of ego. And when you feel pain, you want to drop the ego. And when the same ego when brings happiness, you want to nourish it. Both happiness and sorrow are the two sides of the same coin. Both stay together and dissolve together as well. One moment you want to throw and next moment you want to preserve. How can ego vanish? Ego is the false entity. It appears to exist. However, in reality, it does not exist. If you leave everything in the hands of God, the will, the very source of life, then how can ego remain? Try to understand this. Ego is the sum total of your actions and thinking. Ego is nothing tangible. All that you have done knowingly or unknowingly accumulates to give birth to ego. Ego is the concept of all your doings. Ego is your dead past. From the very beginning, Nanak says, he alone is the doer. However, out of ignorance and negation of truth, you consider yourself or the other as the doer. The moment you consider yourself as an instrument, ego dissolves. Can you really find a person who considers himself an instrument? And there is a vast majority of people who claim themselves to be religious. Try to understand Nanak. He is saying nothing unique. Nanak says it is because of the Hukum that one attains to grace. It is through Hukum that one attains to deep understanding. It is through Hukum that one gets lost along the way. Nanak says, if you are a sinner, never consider yourself to be so. It is his way. You may consider this dangerous. This is really the essence of understanding. The moment you understand that there is no wrong, Buddha calls, never uses the word sin. He uses the word misdemeanor. When you are traveling or going to some place and you lost the way, is it sin? Is it wrong? No. You have a GPS system in your hand. It will recalculate your route and you will go the other. Your problem arises because you do not know the divine will. The divine will is for you to attain to fruition. This negation is the cause of your conflict and misery. out of this arises the concept of sin. Negation creates the situation of self-suffering and pain. And to others, considering yourself to be the doer is the only veil of ignorance. And realization of this is knowing or knowledge or ecstasy or awareness. Understanding of Nanak, compassion of Nanak continues to flow. He says no one is beyond the jurisdiction of this cosmic law. And he says with certitude, one who flows within that cosmic law, how can ego remain there? Never consider these words as mere words. Nanak's breath pulsates through these words. For me, these words are alive, but not for you. I feel the pulse and the essence of Nanak. That is why I am overflowing the ecstasy and understanding of Nanak. Nanak says, one who understands the hukum is free from ego. Devotees sing his glory in many ways. However, none can really explain the magnanimity. How can you glorify the totality? Part can never glorify the totality. All your scriptures are incomplete description of that which is the cause of the entire existence, that which is unseeable. Sun is shining. An artist paints the sun. It may be beautiful, but it is no way it can give light. The poet sings the glory of the rising sun or composes beautiful poems or hymns. All these may touch your heart, may create ripples in your heart. Certainly all these cannot bring light into your inner darkness. All songs, narrations are all incomplete. When you are really thirsty, the word water cannot quench your thirst. If you are not thirsty, then words will do. But when you are really thirsty, then you will search that which is existential. The poets, the singers, the philosophers go on incessantly in their effort to manifest the glories of God. Nanak says, you can go on singing 1,000 times. You may get tired, but his bounties are never finished. Only you have to have the heart to feel, yet still much remains unsaid. This is significant. He alone is the giver. It is he that becomes the life force through your breath. It is he who is the cause of our existence. He keeps on sharing, never demanding anything in return. You got your life so easily that you never realize this. The day you can realize that all that you have is beyond your own capabilities, your life will transform. You will be filled with gratitude towards him. The moment you are filled with gratitude, prayer springs forth deep within. The day prayer will be the expression of your gratitude, not demands. You have only known gratitude for small things. Your handkerchief falls, someone picks to give you, or give you a cup of tea, you are thankful. In all cases, you are thankful for such trivial things. And you never feel gratitude towards God who keeps on giving you. You go on begging and he keeps on giving you. In your religious places, you visit to get your wish fulfilled. Never for a moment you have paused to express the gratitude. To express gratitude is atheism. Atheism means your demands are multiplied so much that you cannot feel gratitude for God. Because of your unwanted demands, you have killed God. theism implies you are filled so much with gratitude that you see the invisible hands of God all around. Theism is the highest state of gratitude and is the Nanak says, religious person is one who is thankful for all that happens. I have heard there was a beautiful sculpture of Jesus in the Basilica in Rome. Almost 30-35 years ago, an American went and he cut off the hands of Jesus. The statue shows that Jesus' body is brought down from the cross and lay on the lap of Mary. Beautiful. Hands were cut off. They tried to restore the hands, but they could not. Then the young sculpturist came and he said, I will restore the hands. So they said, maybe he can restore. He wrote a sentence. And that sentence was beautiful, that completes that. He said, now that my hands are no more visible, and now that my hands are no more visible, I walk through millions of your hands. You cannot see the hands of God directly as Jesus' hands are cut off, but I walk through millions of your hands. I walk through millions of your hands. This is the way of Nanak.